Okay, good morning. Does this work? Hello?
The projector. You went on screensaver.
Oh, well, okay. Hello, good morning. Good morning. I'm Jim Rich from Paris. Okay, and we're going to talk about dark energy. This is what we talked mostly about yesterday. Kaya talked about the galaxies, and this is the local group here. I drew a picture of the Milky Way there. It's about 10 kiloparsecs in radius, the visible parts anyway, and that's 30 light years, 30,000 light years. Okay, and then we're in this little group of galaxies. There's Andromeda, which is about 700 kiloparsecs, and if you go to Chile, where I worked for a long time, you can see the LMC, that's Large Magellanic Cloud, okay, and the SMC, the Small Magellanic Clouds. Those are our not really 50 kiloparsecs. In fact, there's a galaxy right here called the Sagittarius Galaxy, which is about 20 kiloparsecs away, and it was only discovered about 20 years ago because it's sitting, we're right here, and it's sitting right behind the galactic center, so nobody realized it was there until about 20 years ago. That shows that you can still make discoveries about local astronomy. And this is all made of mostly, I mean, what you see is made of normal matter, protons and electrons, but we also believe there are big halos of dark matter sitting around there, okay, and dark matter here, and majorly, actually, dark matter pretty much everywhere, but mostly concentrated around the galaxy, around these galaxies, okay? And of course, there's also, that's about, makes up, if you look at the universe as a whole, that makes up about 30% of the total energy, okay? But most of the energy is dark energy, okay? That was discovered in 1998, 1999, when we realized the expansion of the universe was accelerating. Okay, so this is not what this helps us understand what's going on in the universe, but it's not the subject. We're talking about dark energy, and so the first thing you say is what is dark energy? Okay, most people are always asking lots of questions about cosmology. So the plan of this talk is just to ask questions, and each time you ask a question, you get a new question, and eventually, of course, you'll stop understanding, okay, because it's hard, okay, and we'll start out with some easy questions and keep on going, and at some point you nod off and realize you've lost, that's maybe because it's gotten to the point where even we don't understand the answers to the questions, so just try and keep on as long as you can. So this actually has a very easy answer. The answer, it's the stuff that causes the expansion of the universe to accelerate. Okay, that's an easy, I think I misspelled it. No, it's okay, yeah. So that's the answer to the question, and if that's all you want, we can go home, okay? Because this is basically, unlike that stuff, protons and electrons, if somebody says, what's protons and electrons? Well, you can say all sorts of things. It's stuff that makes atoms and people and galaxies and stuff, but that's basically all the dark energy does. It's something that makes the expansion accelerate. So that's already something that you should keep in mind. It's a very simple stuff. It doesn't have a phenomenology like DNA molecules and stuff. It's just something that does that. But of course, this is now saying, okay, well, hold it. This is not the end of the talk. This is, now you're saying, all sorts of questions. So here are some questions that answer to this immediately, because you'd come to your mind perhaps. For instance, first, what do we mean by the expansion of the universe? That's a non-trivial question, and we'll talk about that in a second. How do we know that the universe is expanding? That's also non-trivial. What does acceleration of the expansion mean? Okay. How do we know it's accelerating? How does dark energy cause acceleration? And these are all questions which the first one's relatively easy, the second one's hard, okay? And you may not follow everything. The third one is relatively simple, then the fourth one is getting even harder, and you may not understand at all what I'm saying about, or talking about, okay, but don't worry. I mean, the important thing about this nice stuff is that each one of these is highly non-trivial. And if you understand the answers to any of these questions, you've learned, you know, something very important about the universe, okay? That's the nice thing about doing cosmology. You always feel you're doing something profound, okay? The last one is very hard. How does dark energy cause acceleration? I think we're now to the level where people that are working in the field would feel uncomfortable answering this question because it's hard. So don't worry if you don't understand the end of that. And then at the end, I can add some questions that I won't talk about today. But if you, in the end, when you ask questions, if you can't think of anything to ask, you can ask these questions. Why is there dark energy? Okay, I'm not going to talk about that, but you can ask. It's an interesting question. I'm not going to ask, why is the universe expanding? That's something that people, you might ask about. I'm not going to talk about that. But if you want, we can talk about it. So I'm just going to go through, except for the last two, I'm going to just go through these questions, okay? And at some point, you know, you'll understand things, and other things you might not. Don't worry about it. Okay, what does the expansion of the universe mean? Well, maybe you already have some sort of feeling about that. We talked about that yesterday, we're supposed to ask, what did you learn yesterday? Well, you did learn a little bit about this. So I'm just going to, unlike George, I'm not going to show these mostly big, beautiful pictures. I'm just going to make my little cartoons that are very simplified, but I can make with free software. Okay, this is Xfig. What is the expansion of yours? Well, first of all, this is the local group, and I drew the picture of the local group. And so inside there's the Milky Way and Andromeda, and then we're surrounded by all these galaxies here, okay? And you can see them on the sky, and there are different distances, and then when we say that the universe is expanding, well, first of all, we notice that they're all moving away from us, and that the velocity v is proportional to the distance with a constant of proportionality called h0. Where am I supposed to? Is this where's the pointer?
That is the pointer. This is the pointer,
and I'm the laser. There I go. Okay, there's this number h0, which means Hubble. Okay, it was actually first measured first written down by Lemaître, but we call it Hubble because he had more an h for the Hubble constant. Though he was not actually the first person to calculate this number. So that's what we mean when the universe is expanding. We say that the velocity is proportional to the distance. And well, this is now you ask another question. Why, first of all, why such a grandiose language? Okay, why do we say the universe is expanding rather than just saying, well, all the galaxies are running away from us? Okay. Cosmologists always do use very pretentious language, and to say that the universe is expanding just because things are moving away from us sort of is curious. And the answer to this is relatively simple. It's because of this famous linearity. Okay, that's the important thing. V equals h0d instead of h0d squared. Okay, you can say what would happen if the velocity was proportional to the square of the distance? Would that make a difference? Well, that's actually the whole point about this question here, why we think it's the universe that's expanding. And the answer is that everybody sees the same thing. This is what galaxy zero sees. Okay, zero is in the middle there, this guy here, and he sees, or she sees, galaxy one going like that, and galaxy two going like that, and four, and the lengths of these arrows are proportional to the velocities. Okay, and now you can say, well, what does galaxy one see? Well, galaxy one, galaxy one is sitting here, and actually this guy or girl is going to see this guy going like that and this guy going like that. And so basically you can convince yourself by adding velocities that galaxy one sees something that's entirely similar to what galaxy zero sees. In fact, it's exactly the same thing. And there isn't, so this is the point, is that you might say that since all the galaxies are moving away from us, maybe we're at the center of the universe at some big explosion. And we just by chance happen to be at the center of everything and of a big explosion. But in fact, that if only because it's linear, with D, okay? There's no center. Everybody sees the same thing. And this is why we use this big grandiose language of expansion of the universe. We say that, okay, the universe goes forever and ever, and we can imagine that everybody sees the whole same thing, okay? So this is already, I think, something that people forget. Whenever you see a formula like that, ask yourself, well, what's so important about the fact that there's no d squared, okay? That's very important. The fact that it's linear is why we talk about expansion of the universe rather than a big explosion where we happen to be at the center. So now we know what does expansion of the universe mean. It means that there's some linear relationship between velocity and distance. So now we ask a little bit harder question. How do we know that the universe is expanding? Well, to know that the universe is expanding, that's the same thing as how do we know that velocity is equal to some linear function of the distance away with a constant, the answer is we need to measure velocities and distances. Okay, so we talked a little bit about that yesterday already, how you measure the distance between the local group and this guy and this guy and this guy, and show that and how do you measure the velocities? So there are two things you have to measure, and these were first done in the early 20th century, okay? You measure V, that's easy, okay? You measure that with a Doppler shift, okay? And so what you do is you put a prism in front of your image, and you divide the light into red light and blue light. And this is what you see for the sun, okay? And you see blue light and green light and yellow light and red light. And fortunately, you see these absorption lines, okay? I think most of these this is due to calcium. This doublet here. And these are, I think, hydrogen lines, okay? Took a long time to understand this, okay? People, they knew that this doublet there was calcium, and that convinced a lot of people in the 19th century that the sun was made of calcium. Okay, and it took a long time, the invention of quantum mechanics, to understand that in fact it's mostly hydrogen. These hydrogen lines are the most important thing. This was discovered by another famous Harvard woman astrophysicist named Cecilia Payne in the 1920s. She was the one that discovered that in fact by applying quantum mechanics to the sun, she discovered that the universe is made of hydrogen. Okay, this is one of the most remarkable discoveries in the history of astronomy, to discover what the universe is made of. Okay, at least the visible universe. And of course, she had a great deal of difficulty convincing people. It took a few years before people agreed with this. Okay, now if you look at this is the solar spectrum, and here's a spectrum from a galaxy that's going at about 1/10 of the speed of light. And you see the same lines, and that's because this galaxy is just made up of lots of stars that are, maybe some of them are like the sun, so you're going to see the same lines. And you can see that they're redshifted. This line has gone up in here, and so this is just means that it's moving away from us, and you can then use the Doppler formula to tell you that that's 1/10 of the speed of light, okay? That's easy, okay? The hard part, it's really hard, okay? This is why Hubble was so important. Actually, he didn't measure the redshifts. This was known before. It was known before that everybody was moving away from us. He just measured the distances, okay? And that's hard, okay? It basically comes down to this. The sun looks big and bright, and the stars look small and faint. And as was discussed yesterday, that's not because these guys aren't as big or as bright as the sun. It means that they're far. So basically, you use all of the other things being equal. Galaxies that are near look big and bright, and galaxies that are far look small and faint. And we saw this picture yesterday. This is the famous Hubble Deep Field. Okay, so you can guess that these galaxies are near, and that all these little dinky galaxies here are very, very far. Now you have to know a lot to believe that, because how do you know that there aren't just a lot of little dinky galaxies that are near? This is not an easy thing to do. And in fact, it was the same thing with stars. People took hundreds of years to show that the stars were just as bright as the sun, and they were just very, very far away. This was something that was only done in the 19th century. Very, very hard to do. There's one star here. Okay, you can see that it's got this funny pattern, is the diffraction pattern on the telescope mount. So quantitatively, how do we measure the distances? Well, here there are two ways. Either you can use standard rulers or standard cardinals. And here I've drawn a standard ruler of length L. You see it on the sky up there with an angle theta between the two ends. And then you can calculate. Well, you have to use trigonometry, but I immediately have the reflex to say this angle is very tiny, okay, because all things up there are very tiny. So that to have a good approximation, the angle is L divided by D, okay? And that's something I wouldn't even bother to think about. I mean, this is trigonometry is far too hard for astronomers, at least most astronomers, so we always write small angles. And of course, if you know the size L and if you measure theta, then you can calculate D, okay? And of course, the answer is, how do we know L? Then that's not easy, okay? The other thing is, if you have maybe this guy is emitting light, and it has a so you can measure the flux of light coming from there. And if it's got a luminosity L, which is not the same as that length L, then the flux will be L over 4 pi d squared. So if you know the luminosity of this guy, okay, then you can also, from measuring the flux of light, the number of photons per meter squared per second, and knowing how many they're produced, you can just calculate from the 1 over r squared law the distance. So the problem is, how do you know L, or the length or the luminosity? And this is the, if you do, you can measure a Hubble diagram. Okay, so this is the, whoops, excuse me, oh, dot. No, press the power key again. No, I don't want to do that. Okay, there you go. Okay. Here's the velocity, okay? This is 5,000 kilometers per second. I ask you a question, is this a big speed? Is it fast? It's fast. Well, no, for a physicist it's slow. Because what's the only speed that counts?
Light,
of course. And this is about 10 to the minus 2, 1% of the speed of light. So this is tiny. That means that when you have the Doppler shift, the lines almost line up. They're just 1% away. So this is a very small. And then you see, here's the D that you measure from. Oh, shit. Excuse me. Okay, there you go. Here, D is from standard scandals. I'm going to talk about that in a second. Okay, and you can see out here, this is it. These things out here that are going really pretty fast. Okay, that's 1% of the speed of light or so. They're at 100 megaparsecs. So when you look at the little dinky local group, which has a radius of about a megaparsec, these things are about 100 times further away. Okay. So the question is, what are these standard candles? Well, the best standard candle in the universe is a type 1a supernova. People at Berkeley were the people, amongst others, were the people that used this to measure various interesting things. Here's a galaxy here, okay. Okay, everything looks okay. There's the center there, the spiral arms, and so forth. And you look there, and there's nothing. And then a couple of days later, bang, okay, you see this. And what's that? That's a supernova. Supernova, it's got a name, 2011 FE. Okay. And you say, well, what happened there? That's an explosion of a star at the end of its life. These things are visible in the sky for about a month. Okay, that makes them easy to observe. Okay, because you can take pictures of this. What they do now is they take pictures of galaxies once every 2 or 3 days. And then one day they'll go like that, and then 2 days later you'll see this new spot there. They're always, at least type 1a supernova, they have luminosities that were pretty much always the same. After corrections there, it's about 10%. But now the question is, how do you know what it is? How do you know what the luminosity is? Because if we want to measure the distance to this guy, we'd have to know what the luminosity is. Well, the luminosity is calibrated by looking at supernovae in galaxies of known distance. So we haven't solved the problem. We have to, if we either we know the luminosity of this guy, in which case we can calculate the distance to this galaxy, or we if we know the distance to this galaxy, we can calculate the luminosity. And before you use supernovas to measure distances, you have to do the first. You have to have some galaxies to which you know the distance. Okay? And this is the hard part. This is what Hubble did. Okay? Here's an example. This is the distance ladder. Okay? This is how they do it. Okay? First of all, they get some galaxies that they know the distance to. Okay? And the galaxy that we know the best its distance, other than the Milky Way, because we're sitting there, is a galaxy called NGC 4258. Okay, that's a strange name. That means New General Catalog 4258. Okay, the New General Catalog is something from the 19th century, but we still use this name. Okay, so first we have to know what the distance to this galaxy is. Okay, voila. Okay, that's on the next slide. Okay, and then what you do, you heard about Cepheids. You have a question? No. Okay. Any questions? Please stop me. You observed some Cepheid variable stars. We talked about Cepheid variable stars yesterday. They're stars that are variable periodically, and they have luminosities. But how do you know their luminosities? Well, if you observe them in this galaxy, you can determine the luminosity of the Cepheids because you measure their flux, and you already know the distance to NGC 4258. Okay. Then you observe some Cepheid variable stars in galaxies that hosted type 1a supernova. And now you can determine the distance to those galaxies because you measure the Cepheid flux and you already know the Cepheid luminosity. Okay? So now you know the distance to these galaxies. So now you can determine the luminosity of the type 1a supernova. Okay? Because you know the distance to the galaxy that hosted the supernova because you've seen Cepheids. Okay? So you've gone from this NGC 4258 to Cepheids to type 1a supernova. And so now you know what the luminosity of a type 1a supernova is. And then so now you can observe lots of galaxies with type 1a supernova. And since you know their luminosity, you can determine their distance. And therefore, you know the x-axis on the Hubble diagram. You measure the distance, you measure the redshift, you measure the Hubble constant. Okay. So now I still haven't answered the question. How do we know the bloody distance to NGC 4258. NGC 4258 is a miraculous galaxy because it has a maser sitting in the middle of it. Okay, it's not a real maser that was made by some advanced civilization to help us along. It's just actually just a gas cloud with narrow emission lines, and they call it a maser. It has certain characteristics like a maser. Okay, and this maser, it's a gas that's moving around this central black hole in NGC 4258. So this whole thing here is a tiny part of NGC 4258 is an enormous thing, and this is just sitting right there in the middle of this thing here. So we have this maser, which is what's nice about the maser is that the emission lines are very, very narrow. So you can measure very, very precisely the velocity from the Doppler shift. You measure this, so it's going around and around and around. You see it going around. It takes about a year, I think, to go around. And so you can measure this angle by observing over a year's period. Okay, that's theta. You can measure how much time. It takes about a year, okay, to go around like that. So therefore, you can calculate the orbital period from just knowing that if you assume it's a circular orbit, okay, then it's V is just 2 pi r over t, okay? But now you have everything. You know what this distance here is here. And you know this angle, so you can get the distance just from theta equals 2 r over d. Okay, voila. That's the best way of measuring the Hubble constant. It comes from this one galaxy, NGC 4258. Of course, there are other ways, and other ways you'll be maybe exploring those in the afternoon. Okay, this is the cutest way that's been done. They started doing this about, I guess, 10 years ago, but it's a beautiful way of doing it, and it's hopefully later on they'll be able to get with some new projects they'll be able to get lots and lots of these masers. Masers to use them more and more often. So there you go. So this is the Hubble diagram, okay? I'm always pushing the red button rather than the green button. So this is the Hubble diagram. We know how to measure. We get V, okay? We get the distance now. So the distance is now from supernovae, which were calibrated because we measured Cepheids in NGC 4258, and we knew what the distance to NG 4258 was because it's got a maser in it, okay? And you might say, well, where were those galaxies? You can see NGC 4258 is sitting down here, okay? It's at 5 megaparsecs. And Cepheids, they're not bright enough to see very far. You can see them out to about here. So you might say, well, why do we bother with supernovas? Why don't we just use Cepheids? And the reason is they're not bright enough to see out here. So they're too near to measure H0 precisely because of these random motions they talked about yesterday, okay? Peculiar velocities or particular velocities. Okay, so we're halfway through. What does the expansion of the universe mean? It means that the velocities are proportional to the distance, to the first power, not to the second, to the third. How do we know the universe is expanding? It's because people have worked very, very hard to measure distances and a little bit less hard to measure velocities. So now, what does the acceleration of the expansion mean? Okay, well, that's a relatively simple question. It's much harder to know the answer to whether it's accelerated or not. So I'll just say, well, expansion today and tomorrow. I go back to these nice little pictures I draw. Here's galaxy 0, and here's galaxy 1 and 3, and they have velocity v1 and v3 and v2 and v4. That's today. And tomorrow, well, what's happened? Tomorrow, first of all, you have to remember they're going to be further away because the universe is expanding. So I've drawn galaxy 1 a little bit further away, and 3 and 2 and 4. But also their velocities have changed, and this is a second effect. This is independent, okay, of that. And if the velocities tomorrow are less than the velocities to say that today, that's deceleration. That's obvious, okay. And if the velocities tomorrow are greater than today, that's acceleration, okay. Okay, we can't wait for that because to make the velocity change a significant amount, you have to wait hundreds of millions of years. So it's not possible to do that. It's a little bit better to think about expansion yesterday and today. Okay, it's the same diagram. Yesterday, the velocities were like that, and today they're like that. And so if the velocities today are less than they were yesterday, that's deceleration. And if they're, I think that's misspelled. Oh, gosh. If the velocities today are greater than the velocities yesterday, that's acceleration. Okay, that's just like particles. I mean, it's no big deal. It's just acceleration. If you know about acceleration, and for particles, it's the same thing, except it's with galaxies. So that was easy, okay, but now it's hard. Okay, now you're going to start, if you followed up to here, hold on to your hats. It's going to become harder, okay? And this is something, it's relatively difficult to explain, and so don't worry, okay? If you've understood that, that's already pretty good. Those are already important questions. But how do we know it's accelerating? It's not easy, okay? It was only discovered about 15 years ago, is that right? 15 years ago, okay? But I'm going to tell you how it can be done. It's not the way it was discovered because it was discovered indirectly. I'm going to show a slightly more direct method of it showing that it's accelerated. That's only been possible in the last 2 or 3 years because of some work we're doing with SDSS. George talked about SDSS yesterday. So the question is, how can we know that the velocities were smaller in the past and will be faster in the future? Okay, that is the question. So we can't measure, like I said, we can't measure the future velocities because we'd have to wait too long. However, we can measure the past velocities because, as George told you all yesterday, everything out there we see in the past, okay? So if for instance, this is where we are sitting here in region 1, in region 2, we see all these guys moving away from us. This is maybe some big distance here, like maybe a gigaparsec, a billion parsecs. And they're all moving away from us. But now you can have to imagine yourself. Well, first thing is we see this a long time ago. This was billions and billions and billions of years ago. Now, if we'd been living in those galaxies, and here we wouldn't have seen this movement, we would have seen this. This is what we see. This is what we see from region 1, looking out to this. But if you're sitting here in the middle, you see something that's more or less like this. Okay, so you can imagine now, all you have to do is take these velocities and transform them to what you would see if you were sitting right here, okay? And that's going to tell you not about the expansion rate now. It's going to tell you about the expansion rate was a long, long, long time ago, okay? So that's the basic idea. Now, and if you understand that, that's all cool because that's basically what we do now, but how we do it is really very subtle. And here you're going to say, ah, I'm lost. So just the next two or three transparencies are a bit strange. So we need, like I said, well, this is okay. We need to compare the velocities here with the velocities here, but we actually have to measure the Hubble law, okay? We have to need a Hubble diagram here, which is the one we have today, and we need one that's here, and that's going to be one that comes from billions and billions of years ago, and we're going to compare the Hubble diagram here with the double diagram here. So this is the Hubble diagram here. That's easy. We've already measured it because we've measured standard candles and standard rulers, okay? So now the question is, how do we get the diagram long ways away? This is the hard part, and it's something that's only been done in the last 2 years. Well, first of all, we have to calculate these velocities here, and that you can sort of do by looking at the difference between this velocity and this velocity. It's not quite perfect because it only gives you one component. But that's no big deal because you know things are isotropic, so you can sort of guess what the distribution in the transverse direction will be. So measuring the velocities here is not something which is hard. It could have been done. It's been done for many, many years. Okay. What's hard is measuring the distances, because to measure the Hubble law, you also know the distance from here to here and here to here. And that's hard. How do you measure the distances between these galaxies way, 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 a long ways from us? We can't use standard candles because they're not precise enough. Okay. So what you do now is something that's only been possible in the last 10 years. They use BAO correlations. Okay, now you're saying, okay, he's getting into astronomical jargon. Okay, BAO means baryon acoustic oscillations. Okay, and here, okay, don't worry if you don't understand this. What are baryon acoustic oscillations? Well, baryon acoustic oscillations, well, first of all, what do they do? They're something which is absolutely amazing. They're something that which says that when you have two galaxies, two pair of galaxies, they can be separated by anything, you know, a megaparsec, 100 megaparsec, 200 megaparsec, and they're just random numbers. But there is a teeny tiny excess of probability for them to be separated by a magic number, 150 megaparsecs. This is what's called the correlation from the baryon acoustic oscillations. The universe has been really, really nice with us. They've said, if you look at a bunch of galaxies up there, you measure all the separations, they like to be separated by 150 megaparsecs. That means you've sort of put a standard ruler way out there. You just have to measure the probability for separations, and that probability will be 150 megaparsecs. Where does the 150 megaparsecs come from? Okay, this is really weird. This is amazing. 150 megaparsecs is the distance a sound wave can travel between the Big Bang and recombination, the moment when atoms were first formed. That took about 400,000 years. And so in the end, it gives us 150 megaparsecs. And how does that make this correlation? Well, it turns out that if a galaxy was formed where the wave originated, well, first of all, you're saying, what are these sound waves in the early universe? Okay, the first 100, well, that's another topic. I don't have time to talk about that. Sorry about that. But you can ask questions about that if you want. If a galaxy is formed where the wave originated, another galaxy has a slightly enhanced probability to be formed where the wave stopped. Okay, and that's where this 150 megaparsecs comes from. And this I put here, almost too good to be true. Okay, it's just not nice. Whenever you look out there and you see a tiny enhanced correlation for some separation, that is 150 megaparsecs. It makes astronomy almost too easy, okay? Not quite. Here is a ridiculously simple region of the sky. There is no region of the sky that looks like that. If you see a bunch of galaxies, and you see a bunch of galaxies here, and you see a ring around them, okay, and you say, what is the distance between there and there? Well, you know what it is. It's 150 megaparsecs, because I told you. That's the distance a sound wave can move between Big Bang and recombination. But that's not what you see out there in the sky. You see a mess, things like that, okay? But now, with powerful computers, you can do correlations, and you can statistically find all these rings, okay? And so you can, looking at this thing out here, you can say that 150 megaparsecs is this distance from here to here, okay? Because you just have to statistically do that. This is really cutting-edge research. This is something that couldn't be done 10 years ago. Only it was discovered in 2006. So there you go. Now, I just come back to this to remind you. So we know how to measure the Hubble diagram out here. We don't really measure the Hubble diagram, but we measure the velocities. We know how to now compare directly these velocities with these velocities because we have the Hubble diagram here and the Hubble diagram here. And what do the results give? And this is something that's last 2-3 years. Okay, so here's what the velocity is. It's actually the Hubble expansion rate divided by 1 plus the redshift. Don't worry about that. This is time. Okay, this is redshift 0, redshift 0, redshift 1, redshift 2. That corresponds to time. This is today, when the universe is 14 billion years old. And here's the velocities today. They're sitting up here. We have points here when the universe was about 7 billion years old, okay? And the velocities, first of all, you see they're much smaller, okay? That means that between the time when the universe was 7 billion years and 14 billion years, it accelerated. Okay, that's acceleration. And just recently, we've got another point out here, okay? This is at 2 billion years, okay? It's a redshift of about 2.3. That's the project I'm working on. And we have now a measurement out here, and what we can see here is that now, in this part, the universe is decelerating. So the universe, the expansion was decelerating from 2 billion years to 7 billion years, then it started accelerating. Of course, we'd like to have a lot more data to confirm this. This is really new. This is something which was first published a year ago or so. So deceleration, the velocities are big, the velocities are small, the velocities get bigger again. That means we're accelerating. Okay, that's the most direct way of doing it. And the way to do it is to measure, somehow project us back into the past and measure the Hubble diagram out there. We can it's like sending Edwin Hubble back to billions of years ago. He was a strange guy. Probably people would have liked to have sent him back there. Yes?
So you're saying that it was slowing down at first, and yeah, then it was accelerating.
Yeah.
Yeah. On the same direction.
Well, yeah, everything's still moving apart. Yeah, it's always moving apart. Voila, but they're slowing down at the beginning. You know, so they're moving apart fast, and then they're moving apart slower and slower and slower, and then they start speeding up. But the expansion—it's always been expanding, as far as we know. So it's not, the expansion is never in question. It's just the how fast they're moving apart. Okay. Voila. How much time do I have left? Oh gosh, okay. We can take a break. Want some coffee? No, something like that? No. Okay. What?
40 minutes.
Oh God, okay, so you can ask all sorts of weird questions, okay. So, that's the thing. Now, I don't know how many of you people understood everything there, but a lot of this stuff is a bit simple, but don't worry, yes? You've got a question, yeah? This is it's today. It's now.
And going to the right is going backwards.
Backwards in time, yeah, I'm sorry. Astronomers always do that.
So you said deceleration, and then you have the velocities go down, and then you have acceleration again.
Yeah.
Now, in the, I don't know what you call it, the space time curve that we are represented by Joe Smith.
Yeah, okay, I can draw that. If you look very closely at it, the problem is that curve tries to show too many things. So, but I'll try and draw it. Is this, how do I turn this on?
It shows that the acceleration decreases.
Yeah. No. The accelerator, it's not the second derivative. It's the, let me draw a picture. No, how do I turn this on? I don't have, this is the blast from the past. We don't have, you know, moldy oldie. We don't have these anymore. Gosh, I would have brought my plastic, you know. Yeah. This is great. This is the crisis, okay, the economic. Yeah. I think it may, this is part of the problem, is that.
Chris, we need your help. We need to switch it off. Which one?
So I think what the plot you're talking about is this funny thing where you see, you know, you see a big flash of light here, and then it goes, yeah. Yeah, and then it goes sort of like that for a while, and then it starts going like that. Okay, this is the acceleration, and to see the deceleration here, there's just wasn't enough precision. What you'd see if you blow that up, you'd see something that's this part in here is actually something like that. Yeah, it goes like that, and then it goes like that. Okay. And that's the problem, because they didn't have room. They had to draw all these atoms and DNA molecules and galaxies, and you know, there just wasn't enough room on the plot. Yeah. But if you draw the picture, what this thing is it's something that's, you know, that's like this accelerated expansion in this part here, and then like this decelerated expansion. And then like that, and that you have to use logarithms. You have to take the logarithm of the to show it correctly.
So it's not what I used to read.
What's that?
It's not what I used to read, because we used to read that the universe has always been expanding.
It has always been expanding, because the curve is always increasing. Yeah.
The gradient changes.
The gradient changes. Yeah. Well, but it was decelerating because the slope here is big is
it's always expanding.
But what happens is that the slope increases here, okay? The slope decreases here. And then the slope increases here. Okay, so okay, it's you know, a question of, but you know, this is people get confused on this, because you know they don't live with that. You don't probably spend all of your life thinking about that. Oh yeah. So okay, now we come to the part where, if I ask this question to people, my colleagues. They'll scratch their heads, okay, and they'll say, "Oh gosh, what did I learn at that summer school a couple of years ago?" Okay, so this is something that you know. Don't worry, it's just these are just what we say to each other, and there are certain things on here that I don't fully understand. Oh yeah, you know, admitting my ignorance. But I mean, how does dark energy cause acceleration? This is hard. So I put it here. It's written in small print, so okay, you don't understand it. So how does dark energy cause the acceleration? The answer is very simple, but extremely subtle. The answer is that it has a negative pressure. Okay. Now, first of all, you'll say, what in the hell is a negative pressure? Well, actually, it was on the news the other day, because they have these poor people coming back from Africa. With Ebola, and on the news in France, they announced that they were put in special rooms with negative pressure. And of course, I said, "Oh, they finally found a use for dark energy." And what they meant by negative pressure was that the pressure was below the pressure outside, so the Ebola virus can't come out. So that's not what negative pressure is. Negative pressure really means that the pressure is negative. We usually think of pressure as being positive. So you might say, well, what does that mean? I'll talk about that in a second, what you might mean by that. But before we answer that question, you can say, well, okay, how does negative pressure cause an acceleration? Okay, and this is now we're.
Give them an example of negative pressure, a rubber band.
Well, but that doesn't cause acceleration. That's a.
If you have the universe with a rubber band.
Okay, yeah, okay, you can think about, you know.
It's just tension.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's true. I mean, if you have a box full of gas, okay, it tends to push things apart. And that's positive pressure, and a rubber band has negative pressure. It makes it, you have to work it to set it apart. But the problem is that with that analogy is that it makes you think that the positive pressure should accelerate the expansion, because it makes the balloon blow up. So I don't like to. Your comment is well taken, Professor Smoot, but I think it confuses the students. No, the problem with this is that it's so hard to explain this. I mean, you're right. That is an example of a negative pressure, but it's not a negative pressure that's going to cause the universe to accelerate. But you're right. Perhaps, let me think about that. If you put the universe full of rubber bands, well, it wouldn't be enough negative pressure, probably. I think the rubber bands would just come back down to their.
You need special rubber bands.
Yeah. Yeah, special rubber bands. Okay. But that's an interesting point. Okay. So anyway, I'm going to ignore that, and I'm going to ask. So, how the hell does a negative pressure cause acceleration? Okay, and that I can sort of make a plausibility argument here. It's getting longer, and lots of words. Whenever you put lots of words, that means we don't really understand it very well. You know, if things were simple, you'd just say it, and oh yeah, of course. Okay, so I put lots of words here. So the answer is, this is a plausibility argument. Positive pressure, well, what's positive pressure? In a gas, it's thermal agitation. It means that the molecules have velocities, okay? Now, you remember from relativity, E equals mc squared, that's going to sort of, this movement is going to increase their effective mass or whatever through E equals mc squared. Okay, well, this is not how most physicists would say it, but I'm going to say it that way anyway. And then you say, well, okay, so maybe that means that a hot sun has a little bit more gravity. So because of the pressure, because of the thermal motion, it's increased the gravity. Okay. So therefore, now by analogy, I say if there's something with negative pressure, that should decrease the gravity. Okay. And that's actually what happens. So now this isn't meant to convince you. It's just meant to say, oh, well, if positive pressure increases gravity because of E equals mc squared, maybe it's not so stupid that negative pressure will decrease the gravity. And so a negative pressure decreases the gravitation. And dark energy, if the pressure is sufficiently negative, it overcancels the attraction between galaxies, causing acceleration. Yes? It's not, yeah. See, the problem is the dark energy has no particles in it. Dark energy is precisely the kind of energy which is not associated with any particles. It's called vacuum energy by particle physicists. It's the energy which is there when there are no particles. And so you can't associate it with any thermal, with any movement of any particles. This is another thing you can say. We could spend all the rest of the weekend talking about dark energy, because it's hard to come to grips with it, okay? So if the pressure is sufficiently negative, it overcancels the attraction between galaxies, causing acceleration. If you believe that, okay, you're not gullible, you're just saying Professor Rich has made a plausibility argument. And you'll have to, now, in the next, Ed is going to talk about general relativity, so he'll tell you how this follows from Einstein-Hilbert action, you know, and path integrals, and so then you'll be convinced. But that's far beyond my competence. Okay, you'll have to go to the next. Yes.
Yeah. And
that, We're going to get to that in a second. Excellent question. The answer is no. It stays the same, and we'll see why in a second. Yeah?
I want to ask two things.
Yeah?
In the first instance,
where the language is degrading here.
We measure the rate of separation of the galaxies by looking into the past.
Yeah.
Now, since the accelerating universe, accelerating expansion started 5 billion years ago.
Yeah.
So does that mean that if we look further into the past than 5 billion, we do not see an accelerating expansion?
Yeah. That's precisely this point here. It's this guy here. You see, it's coming down, decelerating, and going up. Okay.
So when we look further back, than there is no acceleration.
Yeah, there's deceleration. Yeah. In fact, we've looked. If you look, you can go back further. Nucleosynthesis.
The next step. I've asked it on a forum on the internet, and I've been given sort of an answer. I asked whether there is any evidence of a rate of increase of acceleration.
Oh, that's another derivative. No, we're not good enough. Physicists can only measure two derivatives. It's just, I've never seen anybody that claimed to measure a third derivative.
Yes, if there is a fixed acceleration, it means one thing. If there is a rate of increase of acceleration.
Yeah, we're not to that point, yeah. But actually in inflation, that's comes down to the spectral index of, okay, this is technical, but in the spectral index of perturbations from inflation does that, but it's the acceleration that occurred at the beginning here. That we actually have, I guess, measured in some sense the third derivative, because we know the...
Yeah.
But this part here, which is studied with entirely different techniques that I won't talk about, the beginning and the inflation, that they actually do measure the third derivative. So what I said is wrong. I'm not good enough for that. Okay, with this stuff in here, we can only measure two derivatives. Okay. So there we go. Positive pressure. Okay. Now. So now, here's another question, okay? And this comes into one of somebody else's question, okay? And this is about what's going to happen in the future. Besides causing acceleration, what does dark energy do during the expansion? And the answer to that is nothing, okay? And why is that? Substances with, that should be pressure. Okay, I made a mistake here. Substances with positive pressure. Okay. Yeah, I'd have to. Okay, this is pressure. Substances with positive pressure do work during the expansion. Okay, maybe you know. So now you're going to get into high school physics and stuff. Okay, maybe you remember this. Okay, for instance, when you have a gas and you expand it like that, it does work against the walls and it cools off. Okay, so and that during the expansion, it causes the density of energy to decrease with time. Okay, now dark energy has just the right amount of negative pressure to keep the density of dark energy constant over time. Okay, so it stays the same. So the density of everything else is decreasing with time, like galaxies. They're moving away from each other. And so they become farther and farther apart. So the number of galaxies per square cubic megaparsec, which is about one, of order one now, there's about one galaxy every cubic megaparsec, if you want to keep that. Now, in billions of years, that number will have gone down. But the dark energy doesn't go down. And so this says, well, the universe, so doesn't that means the universe isn't expanding for them? Well, no, because what is the universe expanding? Okay, the universe expanding is all these galaxies moving apart. But dark energy doesn't have any particles. There's nothing to move apart, okay? So it's totally obvious that for a particle physicist anyway, that the vacuum, okay, there are no particles in it, so there's nothing to move away, so there's no reason why the density of of vacuum energy should decrease with time. So it's totally, and so it's obvious once you've thought a lot about it, the dark energy will just stay constant. And so that means, that tells you already what's going to happen in the future. Well, first of all, it tells you that the dark energy density was mostly matter in the past. That's because in the past, things were very dense. There were galaxies that were very close to each other. And during that time, we were doing deceleration. And it's mostly dark energy now and in the future. And it will become more and more the case. Now, I don't know if this transparency is going to work. Yes, here I've now added something to the diagram. I've still got the galaxies moving away from each other. And now this gray stuff is what I call the dark energy. Okay, so this is stuff there. And you can see there are no particles in the dark energy. So I haven't put any little arrows indicating things are moving away. So that means that our future is this. Okay, in the future, we'll just be sitting here in the local group. Okay, we'll be the Milky Way and Andromeda and the Magellanic Clouds. Until the stars all stop burning in some tens of billions, 100 billions of years. But around everything it's gone away. Okay, so it'll become more and more and more difficult to do extragalactic astronomy. But you'll still have this dark energy. And it'll still be there, and it'll still have the more or less the same density of energy. And so now you can say, well, how will we know that it's there? This is an interesting question. Can you think of an experiment in this situation to show that there's any dark energy around? It's not an easy question to answer. If you want to ask that question, you can, because this is the end of the talk. I have no more transparencies slides. So thank you.